The all camera's right. pointed at us?
Yeah. All right. All right. Well, Mattie, first off, I want to say thank you for doing what you do. And because, you know, you're serving, you know, God, but you're also serving in such a way that you're just bringing the message of hope to so many people that would have never heard it. And I want to thank you for that. I want to thank you for touching lives. I know lives that you've touched. And just, it's an incredible thing.
Thank you.
And I want to thank you for being faithful in that. And, you know, laying down whatever you could have been doing to do this. I just want to say thank you for that.
My pleasure. Thank you.
And you have a message for, I think, the body of Christ today, that there's more to Christianity than just, you know, of course, going to church and playing the church thing.
Yeah.
And so in the songs that you've just recently written, and knowing the scope of things that's happening right now, what do you feel is the most pressing message that the body of Christ needs to hear?
I think that we need to understand the most pressing message. It's a hard thing to narrow it down. But I think that the most pressing message, as I see it, is that we need to understand that there is no middle ground with Yeshua, with Jesus. And what I've found more often than anything else are people that say, yeah, you know, I'm a Christian, I believe in God, and they just leave it at that. But Yeshua, he didn't leave it like that. He didn't allow people to stay in that place. He would say to a rich young ruler, go and sell all you have, give the money to the poor, and then you can come and follow me. If you want to be my disciple, you have to take up your cross daily and follow me. And that meant something significant to them. These are people that were familiar with the horrendous death that a cross entailed. And then toward the end of his ministry, he would say to all these people that said, Rabbi, we'll follow you wherever you go. You know, we'll whatever it costs, we'll follow you anywhere. He says to them, I want you to eat my flesh and drink my blood. Now, I know that we as Christians have some sort of, you know, spiritual paradigm or church paradigm for that statement, but you know, the reality of that statement in our time as well as theirs is that's a crazy thing to say to people. If you want to follow me, you have to eat my flesh and drink my blood. What? I mean, that's an insane thing to tell people. And actually, as a result of that, it says that everyone left him. Hundreds, maybe thousands of people that were following him at that time said, this is a hard teaching. They turned around and left, all except for the 12. And then when Yeshua says, after that, he says, why didn't you leave me? Peter says, you have the words of life. Where else would we go? And what he was doing, what Christ was doing in all of these situations is he was provoking people. And he was saying, will you still follow me if it gets costly? Will you still follow me if it gets uncomfortable? Will you still follow me if it gets weird? Will you still follow me if it means for you something so much more harmful and so much more destructive than you thought, or maybe than you were used to with other teachers? Because he's not looking for a bigger ministry. He's not looking for more people. He's looking for more devoted people. And I think that we in the church, we try to shrink down the cost of discipleship. We try to say, well, you know, you don't have to change the music you listen to. You don't have to change the movies you watch. You know, you don't have to change the, your sexual habits. You don't have to change the way you eat. You don't have to change the way you spend your money. Just pray this prayer. Just come up to the front of our church building and pray this prayer and you'll be good. You know, and the reality is that's not it, man. Jesus was provocative. He provoked people to a point at which they either had to say, no matter where you live, lead me, I will follow you, and you are the Lord of all of my life, or they'd have to leave. There's no middle ground. Yeshua didn't allow lukewarm Christians to hang around him for very long. You know?
What do you think you would think about this stats that just came out recently with George Barna? He said 91% of Christians do not have a biblical worldview.
I think that is a generous statistic, 91%. What I'm saying. Yeah. I'm saying to say that 9% of us have a biblical worldview, that's a generous statistic. But, you know, to be honest, man, I think that the concept of a biblical worldview is something that is so subject to the opinion of the person taking the poll or making that statistic that I don't even know that I could stand on that. I mean,
just,
I don't know.
What it was six basic theological questions.
Okay.
You know, was Christ sinless?
Yeah.
Did God create the world? And, you know.
Okay.
And
basic questions.
Very basic.
Well, hey,
Christianity 101.
Yeah.
And
I guess it's not surprising.
Yeah.
You know? So, but Jesus didn't sort of fair weather friends didn't do very well around the Mystery of Christ, you know.
I was just at a major event a while back, and they did an altar call, and they basically preached Christ without repentance.
There's no such thing.
I agree. So what do we do with that message? What do we do with the kids who are coming to Christ under that message that, hey, you know, they said, I just need to come to them.
Yeah.
They didn't say anything about repenting.
Yeah. Well, they're, you know, I always thought it was a weird thing that there are evangelists that only preach at churches. You know, as somebody that would identify myself as an evangelist, you know, who's in bars and in clubs and in secular, on secular tours and in secular culture, I always thought it was a weird thing that this guy has the word evangelist on his business card and all he does is go on from church to church and preach, you know. Yeah. But the reality is, man, we desperately need evangelists in church. We need people preaching repentance. We need people preaching salvation. We need people preaching the message of redemption and the grace of God that is able to free us from sin in the church, because apparently a lot of times we're not getting it.
We're not getting it, and yeah. It just seems just like mainland denominations. A lot of denominations now are saying that, well, you know, we're at the point now where, you know, you don't have to change sexual orientation because we know that, we understand through modern science that that's how God made you, and that's okay.
Uh-huh.
And believe it or not, some really major parts of Christianity are aligning themselves with that.
Yeah.
So it's... There's a war, I think, but I think the war not only to win souls, but there's a war within the church to truly identify with Christ himself. You know?
Yeah, I mean, I'm not really fighting anybody, you know. I'm fighting for people, you know. I'm fighting for gay people. I'm fighting for lukewarm Christians. Shoot, I'm fighting for burning, passionate, zealous Christians. You know, whoever, I don't care who you are. You know, Muslims and suicidal atheists and drug addicts, I'm fighting for them, not against them, you know. So you know, I believe when I look at them, man, I see a tremendous amount of potential and a tremendous destiny, and that God designed them the way that, you know, the way that they are with their gifts and their talents to be used for his glory, you know. And I don't think there's a person on the planet that is not capable of displaying the glory of the Lord if they're willing to receive the lordship of Yeshua Jesus. So you know, whatever that looks like, if that means changing my eating habits, my finances, you know, obviously I dealt with porn as when I was younger, and that was a thing that he dealt with me as well. And so, you know, there were and you know, I'm displaying the glory of the Lord as well as I can right now, and I plan to do it better tomorrow, you know. Okay. So I think that you know, with the polarization of people with a biblical worldview and people that are willing to compromise to suit the culture, I think that we could potentially get in danger of getting into an us versus them mentality, where we are fighting against people who don't agree with us instead of fighting for them. And I think that's dangerous. You know, I think if we were people that really have a biblical worldview, then we need to understand that I'm a sinner saved by grace, as much as anybody else could be, you know. And I read a quote recently that said Christianity or Christian evangelism is one beggar telling another beggar where he found bread. I think that's really good.
That
you know,
very good.
That it's I don't necessarily have anything to offer people, but I can point them in the right direction.
I want you to understand and make no mistake about it. The blood of Yeshua Jesus, the Son of the living God, was worth every heart. It was worth every moment of your life, every word you would speak and every thought you would think. So we stand up here, not so that you might feel good about yourself, but so that the King might get exactly what he deserves, which is all affection, all glory, all praise, all honor, and all thanksgiving. This is not for you. This is not for us. We don't dedicate this to anybody in this place. We turn our eyes to the King and we say, only he is worthy of our efforts. Only he is worthy of our praise. And we give this all to the Lamb that was slain, Yeshua Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God.
Do you think discipleship is missing in the church?
Yeah, absolutely. I think we've kind of made our churches operate like corporations, you know, where we have a CEO, we call him pastor, and there's a board, and we, you know, we call those elders, and the board is able to fire the CEO if they feel like he's not doing what is in the best financial interest of the company, You know, which is ridiculous because the church is supposed to be a family, you know. The kingdom of heaven is not a democracy. You know, if you are called to be a pastor, then this is going to sound controversial and really crazy and freak a lot of people out, but if you're called to be a pastor, then you're called to be the head of the household, which is your church. And if there's 10 people in that church, then great. If there's 10,000 people in that church, then great. But if you are the pastor, then nobody should have the right to fire you.
Yeah.
You know, it was your vision to start this church. God gave you the authority to start this church. Now, that doesn't mean that you should be without accountability, but that means that there shouldn't be people. If people are coming to your church, then people are coming to your church. Right. You know, and that man is accountable for the way that he runs that church. So, yeah.
I feel lucky because I actually go to a church, a pastor-led church. You know, cool. God gave him a vision to start a body.
Yeah.
And he's remained the head. And yeah. It's just the way it is.
That's great, yeah. And he's a trustworthy man.
He is. And he pretty much says, you know, if you have an idea and you want to run with it, he says, I'll go for it.
Yeah.
He said, I'll watch you. And
yeah.
I said, if, you know, I need to get involved, I will. Maybe we need more of that.
Absolutely.
I'm not.
You know, yeah. I think, you know, we've tried to, yeah, we've tried to allow people to come to our churches and hide. You know, you can come to our church and, you know, hear a good teaching and hear some good music and then leave and feel better about yourself for the next week. But, you know, the reality is the word pastor, P-A-S-T-O-R, is Latin. It's a Latin word that means shepherd. Yeshua, Jesus, describes a good shepherd as one who knows his sheep by name and the sheep know his voice. And, you know, I would go as far as to say that if your pastor doesn't know your name, then he's not actually your pastor. You know, that doesn't mean he's not a pastor.
Right.
It doesn't mean he's not a great pastor. Right. It just means he's not your pastor, you know.
Yeah.
He's not the one that's leading you. If he doesn't know your name and you don't recognize his voice on an intimate, personal level, then he's a good teacher, you know, and maybe you love listening to him and it really does help transform your life. That's great. There's nothing wrong. You know, I'm not downplaying what he's doing. But he's not pastoring you. By definition, he's not pastoring you. You know, and I think that people need to understand that and really seek out discipleship, seek out a pastor, somebody that can get in their life and get in their business and deal with their issues and hold them accountable to what God has called them to.
What do you think the role of the teacher is in the body?
Well, I think...
Is it missing?
I don't think so. I think that... I think there's a lot of people that are great teachers who maybe go by the title. We've made pastor a really culturally acceptable title. So I think that there are apostles that call themselves pastors, and I think that there are teachers that also call themselves pastors. I think, for example, I think of Rick Warren, you know, who is a great pastor, but for way more people than he is a pastor, he's a teacher, you know, and that's an awesome thing. But people still call him Pastor Rick Warren, you know, because he is a pastor. But for most of the people that read his books and listen to his teachings, he's not their pastor. He's a teacher.
But I guess we can get back to music. Where's For Today musically? With the new album, which I don't have yet, by the way, I had to call Razor and tie up because I don't have it. Are you going towards a new direction, or are you rediscovering an old direction?
I don't know. I've heard people say both. I've heard people say, wow, this doesn't sound like anything you've ever done before. And I've heard people say, wow, this sounds like your older stuff. It's definitely more metal. Than the last few albums. I think those are more kind of hardcore, moshy, you know. But this new album is definitely more metal, more like shreddy and stuff. But, I mean, obviously it's still heavy. It's still For Today, you know. Still have breakdowns and bass drops and stuff. But, it's definitely the most mature music we put out. It flows the best. You know, our transitions are better. And, you know, part for part, I think it's the best material we've ever put out.
Awesome. Now, any plans on a new tour coming? After the festival season? Or?
Maybe. Nothing I can announce right now, but we got some stuff in the works.
Yeah, you have with someone or solo tour?
We'll be with people. It'll be good.
All right.
Yeah.
Sounds exciting.
Yeah.
All right. And any more spoken words albums coming out?
Yes, actually. I'll tell you this because you're my buddy. But I just finished recording the first single off of a new spoken word album called See the Storm that I'm actually going to be announcing next week.
Awesome.
Yeah.
So I definitely need a copy of that.
Yeah. All right. Hey, as soon as I get it, I'll just shoot it over to you.
All right. Awesome. Thank you, Mattie. Thank you so much, man.
Hey, my pleasure. Thank you.
You're good. Nailing it.
Sweet. Nailing it.